Environmental journalism and environmental activism, there seems to be a very close relationship. But some slight difference. And the activist goes out to project an issue. The activist, environmental activist, wants to show physically, you know, sometimes aggressively, make their views known publicly. And sometimes they can use some unprintable words, you know, which we wouldn't like to print in the media, use banners, physically, they demonstrate. But for the environmental journalist, he is to observe, watch them, and report whatever happens. But, and also follow the ethics of the profession. Follow certain rules, certain guidelines before publishing whatever he sees. But over the years, with the emergence of environmental consciousness in Nigeria, coupled with the growth of environmental journalism, the environmental journalist has been able to relate with environmental activists in telling their story. There's been a symbiotic relationship between both groups. Sometimes the environmental activist has an information, they make leaflets, press releases, posters, they walk into the newsroom and share with the environmental journalist. Sometimes they don't even know the environmental journalist through his own movement around, might even spot some danger or through the information available to him, through researches and studies. So the environmental journalist might just go out for the story and now need the environmental activist, call their attention to it, and need their comment. But the relationship got almost bitter under the military when, during the Niger Delta Ogoni crisis, when Ken Sarua was murdered. But before then, Ken used to also relate, being an environmental activist, relate with the media, and the media were projecting the issues of the degradation of the Ogoni land. But when Ken was arrested, it became also fashionable for the military to go after anybody who reports the environment, especially the issues that related to Ken or the Ogoni struggle. So at that time, the relationship was bitter and was sour. But later on, when the civilian regime came in, there wasn't much pressure or anyone breathing down the throat of the environmental reporter not to report something, or for the environmental to be too sensitive or to be too careful in reporting some of these issues. But generally, the relationship between the environmental activist and the journalist is very mutual, is cordial, and I've seen instances where some civil society groups or NGOs on the environmental front will call me and say they're having an event, and I go there. For example, Nigerian Conservation Foundation, they're doing wonderful work in Lekki. And like I said, we need to know the history of certain issues before we can say, look, Lekki used to be a very peaceful place, serene, in those years. And thank God that people like Shifa Seledu, Late Seledu, Asiodu, and Leventis, they formed the foundation to be able to secure some parcel of land in Lagos to have those nice wetlands still remaining. If not, there wouldn't have been any area where nature is still being protected. Lekki used to be called Igbo Efon. And Igbo Efon in Yoruba language means the forest of the buffaloes. But I'm sure when you go to Lekki this week, you didn't see any buffalo. The buffaloes are gone. And just on the other stretch outside Lagos is Ogun State, where Lekki also had boundary with Ogun State. You have elephants. And they still have few elephants, but nobody will believe that they still have elephants very close to Lagos as neighbors. But there is a group called Pro Natura, also working with NCF to still see how to protect some little elephants that are remaining in Omo Forest, very close to Lagos. But unless something is done, and again with the activism of the civil societies and the environmental journalists to draw it in the throat of the policymakers and the government, they may not know the richness of our biodiversity, of our ecosystem, that, for example, we human beings, we breathe in oxygen and take our carbon dioxide. The plants take it in return and we take it from the plants. And there's that relationship. Imagine a world without trees. It means there will be no human beings. But people just wonder, why should the government tell them not to cut down trees? But also that has to also relate to issues of energy supply, which is a problem in developing countries. So with civil society, we've been having a wonderful relationship.